This is Ham Radio Now, episode 263. Whoa, we're up to 263. Let's learn more about DV4. This is going to be a product show. Yeah, don't do those very often, but this is going to be like a product show. DV4, particularly I'm interested in that DV4 mobile thing, but we'll talk about all of their products. So that'll be coming up in just a minute. As usual, I've got to do the fundraising. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. There's our website. You did the click to enter thing. And I'm going to talk about, right now, I'm going to talk about the Kickstarter. So come by the website, click to enter, and there you will see the Kickstarter deal. We're doing this Kickstarter to shoot video at the Tapper Digital Communications Conference, which is coming up in Florida in September. So if you're interested in helping out with that, before you go to click on the pig and do a standard contribution to Ham Radio Now, consider the Kickstarter, because that's got a deadline and a goal that has to be met. So just click on my face. Let's see how the Kickstarter is doing. Oh, not bad. We're over $3,000 of the $5,000 goal. 31 folks have helped us out, and we have 24 days to go. I think we're going to make it. So hamradionow.tv and stop by the Kickstarter. Now, for this program, for DV4, well, tell you what, let me go back to the web here for a second. A couple of days ago, I stopped by Reddit, and I spent the morning doing an essay about digital voice after making the last program with Bruce Perrins and Chris Testa. And I've tossed a lot of stuff at Reddit because they don't want me to just advertise my programs over there. And there's a couple of folks that always get mad when I advertise a program, and they say, "This is Reddit spam. You shouldn't be doing this sort of thing." And the Reddit folks, they all say, "It's okay. Calm down. It's okay. He contributes to Reddit beyond just his shows, and you know, in about the right ratio." They want like a 9-to-1 ratio, I understand, of contributions. And then you get 9 contributions about stuff you know, answering questions, things like that. And then you can kick in a promotion. This was a little different. This is the thing that I put up there. VHF, UHF, digital voice, a peek into the future. And it took off. It's 59 upvotes. No one upvotes my stuff. And 62 comments. And the reason that I'm showing you this, other than I want to show off about it, is that, and this is the essay. And, you know, it didn't get a TLDR from anybody. For those of you that are old, TLDR is too long, didn't read. Nobody said that. And it's pretty long. So I talk about, you know, a lot of the digital voice stuff that I know something about. And somewhere down here, I mention this company called Wireless Holdings and the DV4 Mobile. And the DV4 Mobile is, to me, a bit of holy grail, because it is a mobile radio that is promised to do all the digital modes. D-Star, DMR, Yaesu Fusion, P25. We're going to find out about free DV. I don't know about that yet. What I mentioned there toward the end was that their development had been behind closed doors. They haven't appeared at the DCC, haven't given talks at Hamfest. I said that. I don't know if I'm right, and we'll find out if I'm right. But I said that they hadn't given talks at Hamfest. At least I didn't see him at the Dayton, and I wasn't at Orlando last year, they might have given a talk. We'll find out from this guy here. We'll find in a, wait, Uri. We'll find out in a minute. But Chris Testa and Bruce Perrins have laid it all out. The stuff that they were doing, the Katena digital radio that they wanted to be able to do all modes with. You've seen them multiple times on Ham Radio Now. They've talked about it at conferences at the DCC. They've talked about it at the Hamvention. They've talked about it at Orlando, and then they couldn't do it. In the last talk that they gave at the DCC that we just put up last week, they couldn't do it yet. They haven't given up. They're going to keep on trying. But the radio that they were hoping to have a prototype of at this last Dayton weren't able to do. So I mentioned that in this context because this company, Wireless Holdings, to me has been a bit of a cipher. I have seen their website, which is here, and a bunch of their products, and didn't really know very much about them. They just seemed like they existed, but I really didn't understand them. And then here's this mobile thing that that I was talking about. This is the radio that will do it all, in theory. We'll find out. Now, one thing about their website is that it doesn't explain what they do very well. The series of products. The mobile has actually got pretty good explanation. At least it's got a list of features that explain what it does pretty well. But some of their other products, this DV4 Mini, comes in a variety of forms and features, but it never says what it is. You can sort of have a hard time understanding, well, what these products are for. If you already know the market, the purpose for these devices, well, you don't need much of an explanation. You've got a pretty good idea what it is. But if you're starting from scratch, it can be a little bit difficult. They're not the only ones that have this problem. There's a few other products in their category. This one called DV Mega, it's another, you know, it occurs to me that I haven't explained what these are either. They're devices that let you get your digital signal, D-Star or whatever, onto the internet without having a repeater nearby. Kind of the general category. So this thing called the DV4 Mega, they don't explain what that is. If you don't know what they're talking about, you got no clue. Here's another area to explore, this MMDVM. Somebody on Reddit said that they liked that a lot. It doesn't explain what it is. So that is part of the reason for doing this program. We'll find out what these things are. We'll get a better idea of what they can do for you and how you might want to use them. And then we're going to learn about this radio because I really want to know about that radio. So now it is time to bring in my guest. It is your Uli. Let me see if I can how good a job I can do with the German pronunciation of your name, Uli. Uli Altvater. How'd I do?
Altvater, yeah, pretty close.
I should be able to do better because I am half pure German. My mom was German. She didn't grow up in Germany, and her parents were emigres. In her household, German was spoken almost exclusively. But with the World War II thing, you know, I'm a boomer. I was born in 1949. With the World War II thing, she did not feel comfortable bringing in the German culture or language into our home. So sadly, I got none of that other than the blood that's running through my veins. So anyway, Uli Altvater, AG0X, DH6 SAB. Have I got all that right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You are this guy. You are Wireless Holdings. Have I got that? Have I got that sort of right?
My wife and me.
Okay. All right.
Monica, DJ1SW, has been with me for more than 40 years, helping me bringing these technologies to the market.
All right. Tell me a little bit. Let's start with the, what I really wanted to start with was a bit of a history. But tell me, first of all, a little bit about the company. This is not your primary business. It's a sideline ham business.
No, it's a sideline. My primary business, we do LED streetlights with radios in there, camera sensors and stuff like that. And that's typical for the whole group of hams that are standing behind this DV4 thing. We are a group of about 10 hams, 4 or 5 in the core. And we all have companies that the one makes more hardware, the other one makes more software. But we're all hams, and we wanted to do something new, you know, like we had CW, and then we had AM, and then we had single sideband, and now we really want to do the digital thing right.
So the digital thing is now a thing. And so this is where I want to do a little bit of history, and I'll exhaust my knowledge of the situation pretty quickly and then ask you to start filling in beyond that. things sort of began with D-Star. Things began with P25, but P25 was never a ham radio thing. Hams brought it into the ham bands as a digital mode, but it started as a public safety, police, fire. It was expensive. And it went about 10 years. It started in the mid-1980s, and about a decade in, radios were obsolete. The public safety folks don't want to use radios for more than a decade, and so they, as I understand it, they surplus them, and as hams are wont to do, they got them cheap and moved them to the ham bands, and we had a digital mode. Somewhere in the mid-90s. There was no networking to it. It was all standalone stuff. It never got really popular. Then ICOM came along with D-Star. They started developing it in around 2000, released a 1200 megahertz radio around 2001, 2002, that caught a little bit of very specialized interest. But it wasn't until about 2004, 2005 or so, when they released some 2 meter and 70 centimeter radios, that it became a thing for, I can't say a lot of hams, because it's never really been a lot of hams, but it became a thing for enough hams that it started to catch on. I don't know if I can accuse them of being really smart or really lucky, but this stuff was never going to do anything if all hams did was put up some digital repeaters and hoped that a bunch of other hams around town would be real excited about it and buy radios, expensive radios, and get on the air as digital, just a new mode in VHF and UHF. That wasn't going to happen. The radios were too expensive, the mode was too esoteric, and as we've seen when the initial repeaters went on the air, if they went on the air without networking, then the two or three or four hams in a given area that bought the radios, they all talked to each other for a few days or a few weeks, and then they stop being interested. Does this sound familiar to you?
Yes, it absolutely does. And maybe I should elaborate a little bit.
Let me add one more thing.
Yeah, go ahead.
That the smart thing or the lucky thing that they did was they introduced networking to it immediately from the get-go. These repeaters could be connected to the internet and allow you to talk to hams anywhere else on the internet, also using D-Star digital repeaters. And that brought traffic into the local area. Now, ICOM, I'll give them credit for being either smart or lucky, but now I'm going to give them a little finger pointing for being stupid, because they used a Japanese networking system that Americans did not understand and did not like. It was you to me, and that was about it. No groups, no networks, or no reflectors, no group chats, nothing that would allow a whole bunch of people to get on and talk together. So fortunately, the system was open enough, or at least could be reverse engineered enough, that a guy named Robin Cutshaw, AA4RC, who has appeared at a lot of Dayton talks, and you can see him on ham radio now, said, yeah, that's stupid. And he invented something called D+, which gave hams in D-Star the kind of networking capabilities that they wanted, that they had already been using with Echolink and IRLP, that allowed for reflectors where a bunch of repeaters could be linked together and used all day long, and it brought traffic into every repeater market. They connected to some of the busy reflectors. Your repeater could actually be carrying traffic all day long. Maybe not a single local signal appeared, but if you're a local guy, you could at least be listening to something, and you could join in if you want to. And all of that was somewhere around 2010, I think, or so. Yuli, that is where my expertise kind of disappears. I got that far. You know, Robin invented some devices. See if I can hold it up the right direction. Yeah, this time. The DV dongle, the DVAP, devices that allowed you, if you were in places where there weren't repeaters, to get onto the D-Star system. And so now we had the networks, we have local repeaters, we have the devices to let you get on if the local repeater doesn't exist or it's busy or you want to do something that we're not comfortable doing on the local repeater. And, okay, one more thing behind that, and that is to allow the digital signals, the D-Star signals, to get from one place to another and to let the individual hams control what's going on, because the D-Star radio sends a lot of data besides just your voice, sends your call signs, sends connection information to the repeaters. There needed to be a centralized database of who was where, right down to the very individual. You know, I'm in the database, KN4AQ. You're in the database. When I keyed up my radio, it told the D-Star network who I was and where I was over the internet, and swapped that information to every other repeater everywhere on the D-Star network. That database was called the U.S. Trust. And when I did the program Digital Voice for Amateur Radio way back in 2008, the guys in Texas, the K5TIT guys who explained the network to me, explained this thing a little bit called the U.S. Trust, a server that they maintain. And I said, could there ever be another one? And they said, yes. That's all I learned about it. They said, yes, they weren't excited about the idea, but they said that something like that could exist. So there's this U.S. Trust, a server, a big database, spreads information all around the world to D-Star repeaters. And you know what happens when one person owns information? Somebody else says, I don't like the way you're doing things. I want to do them differently. And that happened. And now I've hit my wall. Now, how much of what I said is pure baloney? How much is right?
It's 99% correct. The standard was really developed by the Japanese Amateur Radio League.
Right.
And very often it was said that ICOM has a patent on it or so. And that is simply not correct. All these digital modes, be it D-Star or be it DMR or whatever, they all are based on a codec, which is a little chip where you put in analog on the one side, digital comes out of the other side, made by a company in Massachusetts by the name of DVSI. We call it MB chip. And that is something that all these modes have in common. So, yes, there are other companies that do digital. And you mentioned P25, which is Motorola or Hytera based, Kenwood does something. So it is not as proprietary as it often was perceived. But you're correct in one thing, and I think that's the most important thing about this whole development. Amateur radio is the oldest social network in the world. And to make it really work, we have to be able to talk worldwide. And that is a function we didn't have on the FM repeaters. And by interconnecting them without any losses, like we can in a digital network, we suddenly have a similar functionality as we have on shortwave, on HF. And that's, I think, why it became so successful.
Okay. I guess I'll quibble with one thing. We had the worldwide networking on analog. IRLP and Echolink are the two that I'm most familiar with. There's something called All-Star. There's a Wind System. So there's been linking in analog. And in fact, the D-Star system that Robin Cutshaw put in place, the D-Plus overlay, was sort of designed to emulate what could be done with IRLP and with Echolink. So with reflectors, multiple repeaters being connected together. The Japanese system didn't allow for that. Eventually, ICOM got the message. ICOM America got the message early, but couldn't convince ICOM Japan that something like that was needed. They finally did come out with something just about the time Robin came out with something. Robin's was better. So ICOM has kind of let theirs go by the wayside, and everybody uses Robin's system. So what about this deal where there's additional databases now?
Well, you have to see that Robin did a good job with the D-Plus system, but as you correctly pointed out, somebody else in the world had a better idea, and that was Thorsten Schulze. And well, he built on the existing idea. You know, it's always that you look at what do we have right now, how can I improve on it? And That was Thorsten Schulze, Delta Golf One Hotel Tango. And he built the X-reflector system at the time on top or as an extension or as a new system above and beyond U.S. Trust. And after that, he developed the DCS system, which outside of the United States is the common D-Star system. U.S. Trust is dominant in the United States, but outside of the United States, the DCS is more prominent. And what was done about 10 years ago is that a D-Star system has been built worldwide with a common authentication and routing system. And that has now 120 servers and 20 authentication servers worldwide. It's called the CCS7 system. And that was then extended in other modes, in DMR, in PDMR, into C4FM, into P25, and very soon in NXTN. And that is a standard platform to be used by all hams. So when we are looking at the DV4 Mini, this is like looking at the phone, but ignoring the central office and the rest of the worldwide phone network. And that has been built. And let me mention that the hams in Europe will know that better, that in Friedrichshafen at the ham radio show, the team around Thorsten and Thorsten himself mostly has been rewarded by the very prestigious prize, the Horkheimer Award, by the German Amateur Radio Club, the DIRC, for the work that he put into this for the last 10 years. It was just under the radar in the United States.
It's so far under the radar that I've never heard of it. And tell me the name of it again.
Thorsten.
Not the award, the network. I've never heard of the award either. I guess that's
well. It's the main award that the German Amateur Radio Club puts out every 1 or 2 years. So it's not just another thing on a trade show.
Yeah.
And by the way, when we come up with trade shows, I gave a presentation in Orlando, and
okay, so you did.
I gave a presentation at the D-Star Users Meeting in Dayton, and I also will be at the Tabor show in or the Tabor meeting there in September.
Okay, I was going to ask about that, which means you're going to have your presentation on ham radio now if the Kickstarter is successful. Even if it's not, I'll be there. Well, great. So we'll get to meet live and in person. So that award is kind of like the ARRL gives out some awards, but probably more famous are the Hamvention, Ham of the Year, and technical achievement awards, things like that. So. Something like that. I'd love to be able to get the Friedrichshafen sometime. I'd really enjoy that. And my wife wants to go back to Germany. We spent a little time there a couple of weeks ago on that Rhine River cruise I was talking to you about on the phone the other day. And not to get too political about it, but if one of our two candidates, and I won't mention which one, is elected, Cindy liked Germany so much, she says, let's move there. So,
well, I moved over 20 years to the United States, and I'm a U.S. citizen, and I'm happy here.
Yeah. So you live in Florida?
Yes. Yes. I live in Naples, Florida.
Okay. Do you go back to Germany very often? Go to visit?
Twice this year. My younger daughter had her wedding there just the week before Friedrichshafen. So it was great. So I could go once and, have the... Both nice occurrences, my daughter's wedding and, of course, the ham radio show.
It was very nice of her not to get married on the exact Friedrichshafen weekend.
Well, we were lucky. Yeah.
Negotiated that, I imagine. You know what's happening that weekend? Maybe. So, anyways, my wife would like to go back, and I think that would probably coincide with a good time to visit the Hamfest. So tell me about that network now, the new database system that you mentioned that was developed over there and that now can operate or help multiple digital modes. Tell me the name of it again and maybe go into a little bit about how it's going to work.
Well, the first system that was built was DCS, and that is basically a D-Star system. And it's called the DV4 system, the DV4 network, and it supports multiple modes. It supports DMR, it supports P25, it supports Fusion, C4FM, and all these modes. Now, all these modes other than D-Star have one thing in common, that your call sign is at the beginning of each data packet that you transmit. And but that's only 3 bytes. Now, obviously, both your and my call sign wouldn't fit in there. And in Sweden, they even have now 7-digit call signs. It wouldn't fit in there. So a database based on a standard of the International Telecommunication Union, which is kind of the central club of all postal services or FCCs, logically regulatory authorities, was being used. And that's a CCS database. And that's where all hams that use digital modes apply, and then they get like a 7-digit phone number, and that's why it's called the CCS7. So you have, for your call sign, you have a 7-digit number, and with that 7-digit number, you can now do D-Star, you can do DMR, and so on and so forth. And that's a cluster of about 20 servers. And these 20 servers you register with when you turn your device on. And then you decide, okay, I want to do today DMR, or I want to do P25, or I want to do D-Star. D-Star, I can switch between US Trust, DCS, or X-Reflector. And then I can use these modes. Now, you can interconnect these modes, because you have to understand that the chip that is at the core of all these modes is always the same chip, the DVSI chip. But you can change the amount of data that you use, that you transmit. And the more data you use, the better it sounds. That's why it sounds in the wide mode better than in the narrow mode, and so on and so forth.
Let me see if I can explain, feedback to you what I have understood from what you've said, because it's going pretty fast. So you've got a network, you've got 20 servers. And so
120. That 20 servers that just do the authentication and the routing, find out who are you and with whom are you, do you want to talk. But the conversations, there are about 100 servers.
Okay.
that handle the conversations, and they're all meshed together, so if one goes down, it doesn't matter. It's an IRC DDB database, an internet relay chip distributed database. So if you shoot one or two or three down, nothing happens. It's basically the cell phone systems that the hams build.
So I can connect either my local repeater or one of these devices that connects through my computer. Yep.
UFO mini or something. Yep.
And they point toward one of these servers, and and other users, other repeaters, other individual users point toward the servers. How are the individual places that I would go to? What's the nomenclature? Do you call them reflectors? Do you call them chat rooms? Or
they're called mostly reflectors. Okay. And then you have rooms in there. In the DCS system, for example, you have a reflector, and each reflector has 26 rooms. Like in the US Trust, you typically have ABC, and it also correlates with the frequency in the US Trust. That is not so much the case in the DCS. There you have 26 rooms. In C4FM or in DMR, in DMR we have 1,000 rooms. C4FM we have like in P25 we have 100 rooms, but we have multiple reflectors. To give you an idea, for Fusion we have 3 reflectors with 100 rooms each. One is in Zurich, the other one is in the U.S., and the third one is in Canada.
Okay, so in the U.S. Trust system, there's, I don't know, 90 or more reflectors right now on servers that individuals have put up. And this is completely separate from that, right?
Yes, has nothing to. The only thing they share is the internet.
Okay, and I imagine some, at least with D-Star, they share the method that you get to them. The information that you put into a field of your radio that says, connect my repeater or connect my device, my DV dongle or whatever the device is, connect that to this location. They have to share that in common as well, I guess.
Yes. There are some protocol differences, forward error correction and so on and so forth, that has been improved upon. But on the D-Star side, there are the most similarities, yes. On the DMR side, it's a hierarchical network. So let's say if I call my buddy in Munich for an argument here from Naples, then I connect to what we call a DMR master that goes to an S master to a B master. Then it goes over the Atlantic, and then it goes that hierarchy down. So it's very similar as a public phone system where you have reflectors that are on top of reflectors that are on top of reflectors. And then you try to localize your traffic, while in D-Star you just have a single reflector and that's it.
I sort of understand. How much does an individual user need to understand about this in order to make things work?
I guess you programmed your D-Star radio.
Yeah.
And it is a learning curve. I started with a DVEP, the blue one that you showed at the beginning of your show, I think 5-6 years ago. And I have a background in digital communications. I filed about 12 patents in that field, doing it commercially back 20 years ago. And it was quite a learning curve, even for D-Star for me at the time, because there are very specific terms that you have to learn. And I think that has been a barrier of entry for many hams, even in the U.S. trust time. And that's why we want to simplify that, and with the DV4 mobile, where we do the configuration, the programming centrally through the cell phone, and so that the ham, the individual ham, doesn't have to deal with these complexities.
So a ham using the system doesn't have to understand.
It's more or less you have an iPhone or an Android. You don't care what happens when you dial a number. Yeah. You just hear the ringtone and hopefully somebody picks up.
Okay.
Now,
but since we're hams, we do kind of want to know what's going on under the hood.
We documented it. It's an open system and everybody can improve on it. We have our APIs open, but this allows now the hams to not only rebuild what the public phone companies built with their wireless cellular systems, but we can improve on it. And I would like to elaborate on that later in the show. We really want to add digital modes that just don't exist, that have properties that no other wireless system right now in the world exists, so that ham radio becomes cutting edge again, above and beyond Fusion or D-Star. That's old stuff. There is far better stuff around. That's what we will show in the fourth quarter this year with the DV4 mobile. There are far better things that you can do with digital, and they are far more fun.
I think Yesu would argue with you about their thing being old stuff because they've just kind of come out with it. But the underlying digital technology is not real new. C4FM is not real new.
Yeah, I remember I had a data modem in one of my companies that we developed in 97, and we had C4FM modulation with a megabit, 2 megabits at the time.
1997, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
You were talking about being able to transcode and mix the various systems together. So let me understand that a little better. If I've got a D-Star radio, I can go to a reflector that will carry traffic from... Mm-hmm. From DMR and Fusion radio systems, we can all get mixed together. I hear them, they hear me. Mm-hmm. I hear them coming back as D-Star, and they hear me going to them as either DMR or Fusion.
That's what we do with the DV4 home, and we showed that in Dayton on our booth. It was relatively busy, so not everybody could see it, but we'll start shipping now in the next 2-3 weeks. And what you have in there is a... it's a Unix or Linux computer. The left one, the home, is the better example. And it has two of these MB chips in there. So what you can do, you can receive traffic from one reflector, bring it back to, I'll call it digital analog, like an AVI file, it's PCM. as a codec, and then you re-encode it in another mode. So let's say for the argument's sake, you come in D-star, and you can transmit it in DMR. What you can also do, and we'll have later this year a software for that, you can replace the G2 gateway that you have in a typical ICOM stack with this box, and then you can use your old IC92 or any other D-star radio, connect to your D-star ICOM repeater station, but from there you can directly also connect to a DMR reflector and talk to your buddies that use DMR. And what we do is we just take these two chips, basically go digital to semi-analog. It's not really, it's still digital, 64 kilobit digital, and then you re-encode it in the other mode, and you can select all these codes, and with a knob on the left side, you can select the reflectors, and then you can interconnect it, but you can also talk to the guys. The square, the black square on the right side is just a normal microphone, and you can use it as like a normal radio. It also has a radio in the back, which is a DV4 mini that you can plug in, so you can also run around in your house with your handheld if you want to. That's optional.
I hope there's not going to be a quiz, because I'm only catching some of what you're talking. You are talking to a trained monkey over here right now at this point.
But, well, I left a presentation on my website, so if people want to look at that presentation, that's actually the presentation I gave in Dayton.
Okay, what's the website?
It's on the download.
Is it part of this?
Yeah, it's this website. Yeah, it's okay. Only when you look software downloads. Okay. Yeah, and then if you go lower.
I saw a presentation here.
Right, that's it.
Okay.
That's it. Yep, sorry.
All right, so we can take our time and go through looking at that.
And I'm going sometimes to clubs. I recently did that in Tampa, and give presentations and explain how it works and invite people to work with us on this. Okay. Very exciting.
And did you do a talk at Dayton this year?
Yes, at the D-Star user meeting.
Oh, okay.
At the Marriott or whatever it was.
That was the Friday night?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I should have got to that. Now I know. I was exhausted. I was really worn out Friday. So multiple networks, able to interconnect different systems, and the details of how to do that, we don't need to teach people how to do that right now, and I'm not going to try because my brain hurts already. But these things have all evolved because people wanted to do more than what D-Star started with and what Fusion and DMR started with. The rooms that you've got are also not the same rooms that Yaesu's putting up for their system fusion. They've got
independent.
Own.
There are people that interconnect them. Pascal in Canada is doing that, and there is a group in Alabama that does it as well. So another one in Southern California. So you can do interconnects.
Yeah. How well does this transcoding work? If I'm listening to somebody that's starting out on DMR, gets transcoded to D-Star.
You don't hear a difference.
Sounds like he's
D-Star. I mean, of course, if you come in with Fusion in a wide mode, you will lose some of the quality when you go into D-Star because you don't have as much data. So it will be more compressed. So it might sound a little bit more tinny. But the new codecs, both on DMR and D-Star, if you use an external speaker, don't sound so bad as they did at the beginning.
Yeah. My impression with D-Star is that ICOM screwed up their radios.
I won't comment on other vendors.
Well, if you listen to D-Star on someone who is going into the D-Star network from a computer with a good microphone and listening on a good speaker, it can sound really good.
You're right. By the way, there is a technical reason for that that I can tell you after the show.
You can't reveal it to the entire world? All right. But if you're talking through an ICOM radio and they have the same sound on analog, my old 2820, yeah, it sounds like that. There's no low end at all.
Yeah, there is a reason for that.
Okay. let's talk about your products a little bit. I want to get to the mobile, and I think everyone is sitting around saying, let's get to the mobile. But before we do that, let's talk about the first devices that you came out with. And you were saying that the network that you're talking about is the DV4. Those letters were applied to the network, not just your products. But did I understand that correctly?
Well, the network really was the DCS network at the beginning. And then it's DMR Plus that is mostly used as a network name because that was the next network. And within DMR Plus, we do have the P25 and the Fusion. So there is a discussion in the group whether we should call it Connect Plus in the future.
It grew.
And now with, you know, NXDN on the horizon, you know, DMR Plus wouldn't be really the appropriate name, so Connect Plus would be probably the better name. It didn't really find its way into our documentation. So it was first X Reflector, then it was DCS, then it was DMR Plus. I used Connect Plus in some of my slides already. You know, we are just some hams. We are not a company that has a big marketing department that comes up with these buzzwords.
But you got that Connect Systems company out there that, if you use Connect and they use Connect, someone's going to
Well,
connect.
Again, I don't want to elaborate on other players in the field.
Okay, so let's take a look at what you've got. The home system's not available yet. But these devices...
The boards will probably arrive today or tomorrow. We'll put the next one. We put them together over the weekend. So hopefully next week we are shipping.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah. So... these devices are, let me let you describe what they do.
Okay. Let me go back maybe. DV4 is a DV4 because there was a DV1, a DV2, a DV3 before. And that is, you know, some insiders will know it as a DVR PTR 1, a DVR PTR 2, and DVR PTR 3. And that stands for Digital Voice Repeater Board. And that was a modem that was sold, a few thousand of them were sold. And you could use your old FM boat anchor repeater, add that little box to it, and a PC, or in the later versions without a PC, and it replaced an ICOM stack. So you could basically take a $200 FM repeater from eBay, at that little box, and you had a D-style repeater, homemade, if you want, D-style repeater. And that's what has been going on over the years. So this is the fourth generation, and that software has been evolving over four generations now. Now, what the DV4 Mini does, it is a hotspot USB stick that you can... I'm holding it up here. You stick into your PC, and let me do it right here. Okay, so you have the USB, and you have a little antenna, and you plug that in, and then you have a software on your PC, and then you can connect to all these reflectors. It has only 10 milliwatt out, so it's good for about. I tried it on an exterior diamond antenna, and it was good for about 1,000 feet. If you have a better antenna, we saw more. We saw up to 2 miles. The 2 meter version is a little bit better. And basically, it's your own repeater station. That if you don't have a DMR repeater or don't have a Fusion repeater nearby or a D-Star repeater, you can just take that little dongle, put it on the side of your PC, select a mode, and you take a radio. A little handheld radio, and you use it like you had a repeater in your town. Now, you can also put it in a Raspberry Pi, throw it in the trunk of your car, connect it to a mobile router, and I did that the other day. I drove up, actually, to Cary, North Carolina, where my daughter lives.
That's where I am now.
I know. And I drove up and used it to talk on DMR all over Europe. Having this thing in the trunk with a Raspberry Pi. That's another possibility to do it. Now, in the new version, we have, and I don't know whether that is visible. We have...
Give you full screen here. I'm not sure where that black bar is coming from.
Yeah, well, you see there are two boards in there. And the second board is an MB board. So you can also use the microphone or speaker, like I have here, a headset, to use all these modes. And I don't need a handheld radio with it. So that's a new version.
So that combines these two devices. This is a device that is similar in the original DVAP that Robin Cutshaw and Mo Wheatley invented.
Yes. Yes.
But only works with the D-Star network, and yours yes. works with all of the networks. And
yes.
I remember people asking, this device worked with your computer, and your computer
yes.
mic and speaker, and there's no RF involved.
Yes.
This device does not work. It needs your computer, but it doesn't work with your computer. The computer is just the access to the internet, and you use your radio to talk through it. And people said to Robin Cutshaw, are you going to make something that does both? And he says, well, I already do. You do this, and you take some duct tape and stick them together, and you do both. You can plug both of these into your computer at once and use them at the same time, doing different jobs. But your device does both in one box.
And for all modes.
And for all those modes. So yes. you're way ahead of him. But you had the experience of seeing what existed and where you could go and advance things. Are we at the point where we need to talk about the mobile at this point? Or
if you want, yeah,
okay.
Sure.
Let me dial that up here. The DV4 mobile. And let me ask the initial question here. It says price available in fourth quarter. Is the whole thing available in the fourth quarter as you currently planning is, or is just you're going to tell us what it costs?
As it looks right. Our top developer, Torsten, says, when I ask him these type of questions, he says, the battery in my glass bowl is empty. I can't look into the future. But
yeah.
As it looks right now, I can give you the status. We have 50 empty cases sitting in my garage here. We have another 50 sitting in his garage in Germany. And we have the first computer boards that sit in there, which are technically pretty much identical what you have in a luxury car. You know, we have all these entertainment systems, navigation systems and stuff as an embedded system. That board is a very, very challenging board. It's an 8-layer board, 0201 parts, very, very tight with an extreme temperature range from minus 40 to plus 85 degrees. We have now 5 of these boards, and we have a special version of Linux that Torsten has developed, which is optimized for this purpose. We have selected and are testing the LTE modem that is in there. So we are going forward with a system integration. I had hoped that we would do some beta testing in July. We will not be able to do that, obviously, because July is over in 2 days. But we said in the fourth quarter, you know, so yeah, we goofed up 1 month. We still have another 2 to goof up.
Yeah.
I still hope we make it under the Christmas tree. We're working hard on it, but bear with us. I mean, we are only very few people, but I think I still would give it a 95% chance for Christmas.
Okay, so you haven't gotten all the pieces together yet, and made them all
well,
work.
Well, we showed a working system at the show in Friedrichshafen. You could do Fusion. You could do DMR. P25 was not in there, and the modem, the LTE modem, was not integrated. However, the processor, the main processor that we wanted to be in there, was not in there yet. And that is a processor that is basically a 1.8 gigahertz quad core PC, a little bit larger than a stamp. That is a challenging task. We had a first, the Gerber files and everything in Friedrichshafen. Now it exists. But that has been very, very challenging. It's not only that you have to do the operating system, you have to develop the bootloader, you have to develop the BIOS, everything. And it's a lot of work.
A lot of people, when they first saw this website and the pictures and stuff, and to some extent me, said, this looks like vaporware. Can this really be a product? And and that's one of the reasons the folks that saw you with the hamfests got a better idea that there's people behind this. There's stuff that actually really exists. But that's why I wanted to get you on the show. So beyond a few dozen people in the forums, they can see you live in a person and understand this is something that is coming up.
Yeah. Thank you for giving me the chance to explain what it is. And additionally caused some confusion was the fact that we use an existing enclosure from a Chinese manufacturer that saves us some few $10,000 for the tooling of that case. But everything in there is from us and has nothing to do with the original radio.
All right. So let's talk a little bit about what this will do. The list of capabilities is, you know, it's easy to understand on your website, but still everyone's going to say, really? Can it really do all that? First of all, 3 bands, 2 meters, 220, 70 centimeters. When I initially thought you guys were all European, a lot of your team is European though, right?
Yeah, well, Torsten is moving over to the United States and he's the main developer.
Okay.
And so yes, and I live here in the United States.
The reason I'm asking is this 220 thing, because 220 doesn't exist in Europe. I mean, the band is there, but it's not a ham band.
Well, you see, this is the first shot, and we will have a stackable units later where you have another radio. Pretty much, you might remember the IC901 from ICOM back in the days. I still have one in the container when I sold my home in Germany. And we'll have the stackable boxes, and we'll have a 900 and 1200 version, and we'll have an HF version as well.
Okay, so
the problem that you have is in that box, you want to make it small that it fits in a car, but then the filters get too large. But you can combine the 2 meter band and the 220 megahertz band into one filter as a low pass filter. And then you have the UHF, and then again you have 900 and 1200 megahertz that you can kind of put into one filter. Unfortunately, we were looking at the 4 meter band that is in England and partly in Germany that was available. Then the regulatory authority took it away. That's another one. I think I'm very excited, about HF and 6 meters, because we really think that digital modes on HF have not really been optimized, and we see a huge potential there.
You guys are drooling on your keyboard. Stop. I see you doing that. This is three bands to start with. Now, if you want to add a band when those are available, is it will hold 3 bands and you have to take your choice? Because it's still a small case.
No, so you can do the 3 bands in that single case. And then if you have to add a second case, and there is a serial interface that loops to the next box and to the next box. So you have 3 as a stack. It's simply because you need a PA for each bundle, so to speak. So you can bundle HF and 6 meters, and 4 meters. You can bundle these 3 bands, which obviously are the largest market. So that's why we start with that. What do you do with a D-Star radio in 6 meters? Nobody talks to you.
On 220, you can talk to the guys that are going to buy the Kenwoods.
Well, for example, I had an interesting thing happening to me a few years ago with the DBR PTR. I talked to a few friends in Germany. I was in a hotel room in Doha, Qatar, using Wi-Fi on a German reflector, and there was a Portuguese station coming in, and he came in on an ICOM radio on 10 meters to a 10-meter repeater for D-Star in Germany, and I talked to him from the Azores, where he was, into my hotel room in Doha, Qatar, and I thought that was impressive, and I think there is far more potential on these digital modes than we anticipate right now.
Now, at some point, the guys who say, it's the internet, it's not real ham radio, are going to raise their voices again. But it's still
an interesting point. I met with some staff at the ARL headquarter half a year ago, and I brought the question up, is this ham radio? And I got an interesting answer. What that gentleman told me, he says, as long as there is wireless involved, it's radio, and therefore it's ham radio. And if an older gentleman who is living in a nursing home can't have an antenna and can still talk to his old friends, and he's not even using RF, it's still ham radio for him because it's the oldest social network that we have.
Yeah. I would hate to see everything just carried over internet without any RF involved, because that does take ham radio out of the equation. But for some hams, that's the best they're going to be able to do. But most of these systems, they still have some RF either significantly involved or at least tangentially involved. I mean, with my DV dongles and DVAPs and stuff, the DV dongle, I can talk to other people and there's no radio involved except for we're keying up a repeater someplace.
Yeah, but this is going in the wrong direction. This is the beginning.
Yeah.
When you look how TV evolved, we are using digital TV now. And when you look at the modulation, it's a OFDM modulation, which is like QPSK 8,000 times side by side in one big brick, and that's how your TV signal is transmitted. Now, when you do the same thing on UHF, you can get a high definition picture, a HDTV picture in a 2 megahertz channel in the 70 centimeter band. This is what we can do here.
Yeah, I need to do a show with the TV guys, because I know that's coming. Yeah. I've heard them talk about it.
Yeah, but, and now you can use the same technology in a ionospheric channel, meaning on the 20-meter band with a signal to noise 3 dB instead of 20 dB is what you need if you use D-Star right now. But that's by porting the DVB-T technology into the domain of HF. And that's really where we want to go. It's a platform for going from single sideband to digital, even when you have worldwide connections. So forget about the internet.
So you guys aren't done.
No, we are at the very beginning.
All right. Let's look at some more of your capabilities here. So the current digital modes, C4 FM, which is the ASU system fusion, D-Star, DMR. What is DPMR? Is that a European digital?
No, it's a Chinese one. The Chinese wanted to save some money on the DVSI chips and came up with our own codec. Okay. And we call it experimental. It is tricky because even if you have two radios that are DPMR, they have to come from the same manufacturer. So, yeah, we transport it, but, results vary.
Okay. P25. And so you're networking P25, which originally was not very networkable.
Yes.
In ham radio.
Yes. Yes.
The radios, do they contain things that let you control the networks, or does it
be done? You can use DTMF tones and switch reflector rooms with DTMF. That's, by the way, one of the differences between the US Trust system and the DCS and all the other systems. You can use the DTMF keys to switch reflectors, modes, connect, disconnect, and so on.
So you don't need to program things into your radio, which you can do and put them in memories, and that's handy. But if you want to do something that isn't already in your memory and want to do it on the fly.
Yeah, especially when you travel, that is a problem. And if I'm somewhere, on another continent, it's better I can just type it in and I'm connected.
Yeah, but then you got to know what the code is to type in.
Yeah, you see that on the website. When you go on xreflector.net, you see the DTMF code for every reflector. You just look there on your smartphone, and then you type it.
Yeah, we got the phone, so all right. It's an answer for everything. And NXDN is just beginning to get a little bit of a foothold out there, but it's just another digital mode.
Yeah, we have two repeaters here in our area that we'll bring up in the next 2-3 weeks, and they are brought up by the Marco. We will interconnect them to a few repeaters in southern Germany, in the Munich area.
I've been saying, I do not, people keep saying we should have one digital standard. And people say, and they think that that's something that I'm going to agree with, because I've complained about how many walled gardens there are. But I don't want to see one digital standard. I want to see lots of them. I just wanted a radio that would let me do them all. And this looks it's going to be.
We have 2G, 3G, 4G, LTE, and now we are talking about 5G.
If
you say that one digital standard, then you basically block all future development. That's not the purpose of ham radio. The opposite is the case.
And speaking of television, in the broadcast television business, most people don't know this yet, but it's about to get tossed on its head. You're probably familiar with, you know, ATSC 3.
Yeah.
The current in America, the current broadcast television standard is ATSC. What happened to ATSC 2?
Well, it's the issue is the more resolution you want, going from HD to a 2K to a 4K picture, you need more and more bandwidth.
Are we at ATSC 2 now?
I don't know. I'm more used to the European standards.
Okay.
And they just switched from the HDTV to HDTV 2.
Yeah. So when we go to ATSC 3, which is
probably 4K, I would assume.
It'll handle 4K. A television channel, 6 megahertz wide television channel. Mm-hmm. It will handle a data stream of, if I understand it right, about 19 megabits, no matter what.
Yeah.
19 megabits.
Yeah. You have typically 8,000 little transmitters side by side with 256 QAM modulation and a few pilot carriers in between. I don't know. That's now the European standard. I don't know precisely how it works in ATSC. So if somebody says, Uli, you didn't get that right, I refer to the European standard here.
So you're able to stream about 19 megabits, and you can put whatever you want in it. Right now, what they're putting into it is the equivalent of a DVD standard. It's high definition, but it is the encoding, the MPEG-2 encoding that was done for DVDs. It's the best they could do at the time.
Right.
Well, things have progressed rapidly. And the next thing that came along was H.264, which was fit a lot better picture in a lot less data, less data stream, much higher compression. But the TV stations were stuck with MPEG-2. And now they are going to bite the bullet and say, well, we can't do that anymore. We have to go to something better.
Right.
And not only will it be better in terms of better picture in lower data stream, but it's going to allow them to become much more flexible in what they put on the air. Go ahead.
you have basically in the industry, what you look at is how many bits do I get in a hertz?
Yeah.
And in the old system, you got 1 bit in a hertz, then you got, you know, 2 bits in with C4FM. I think we'll see 5 to 10 in a hertz, 15 bits in a hertz, and it's getting more and more with forward error correction, with multiple pilot tones, and different demodulation schemes that allow you now to refer your signal to the pilot carriers and not to an absolute frequency base that you have in there, and that will allow to use these advanced modes on HF.
This is going to be on the quiz?
No.
So the thing about this, though, is that AT3 for your broadcast television is going to be incompatible with your TV.
Yeah.
Inside your TV.
Away.
Yeah, inside your TV. Well, you got your display, your monitor is going to be fine.
Right.
It'll show everything. But your tuner won't work anymore. The thing that lets you tune into channel 5 or channel 7 or whatever, that won't work anymore. They're going to be able to, if they want to, if I understand things correctly, they are going to be able to take a little slice of their 6 megahertz channel, 19 megabit stream, and dedicate it to good old ATSC, your current stuff. But it won't be that good a picture anymore because they don't want to use up all their bandwidth making that old incompatible picture. For a while, your tuner will be useful. The other thing about that, as I understand it, in reading the trade papers, is that Well, it's stupid to tie a tuner to a display. There's no really good reason to do that anymore, except that the Federal Trade Commission says if you don't have a tuner in it, you can't call it a television. You have to call it a monitor. And the public doesn't understand what a monitor is. They don't get the idea that they're much better off with the tuner in this box and the display in on this panel, and you can upgrade at will without losing the other one. They think television sets got a tuner. So maybe we'll get that fixed. I don't know. Back to your stuff. So doing all these modes, all of the
maybe elaborate on one thing that shows the transfer of that logic that I was just referring to.
Okay.
We will have in the first version a digital mode that is not C4, FM, D-Star, or any of those. It will be a digital mode that is very similar to the ATSC or DVB-T mode, where we can have four repeater stations transmit and receive simultaneously in one simplex 25 kilohertz channel.
That's going to be your own mode.
That's our own mode. Now, that means instead of what we had historically having 25 kilohertz and then 600 on 2 meters, 600 kilohertz lower, we had another 25 kilohertz channel. And then we had cans, we had these duplexers that cost more than the whole repeater. Very often, they need to be tuned. You can have four of them, and you can use the DV4 mobile as four repeaters without using a duplexer. And in total, we are not using 25 kilohertz for one, or 50 kilohertz, really, the upper and the lower channel. We instead of 50 kilohertz, we use 25 kilohertz, and we have four channels instead of one. And so we have eight times the density, and that's the same thing as you described before. And that's really where we have suddenly a chance as hams to be on the bleeding edge of technology again and not trailing it.
So let me back. I can understand precisely what you're talking about. A repeater without a duplexer is going to require time domain.
Yes.
Switching back and forth.
Yes.
And that's it. That is what DMR is doing, but they're not using it to avoid using a duplexer. They're using two channels in one 12 and a half kilohertz.
But we go above and far above and beyond that. Our time slots are very, 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 very short.
There's another system that I've heard described that will do this, and you may be there first, and that is David Rowe's FreeDV VHF mode. I'm sure you're familiar with that.
That is an OFDM mode that is used for HF, and I have been following it. I think it's a cool device. I like the box that they came out with, and I saw it in Orlando, and I was tempted to get one, you know, but I'm so busy. Yeah, precisely. Yeah.
I've never connected.
I think it's a nice device.
Yeah, but he's got a VHF UHF mode that he is planning. That will be not the same as the. I'm sure it's got some underlying technology that's the same as what they're doing on HF. But on HF, they're 1.1 kilohertz. On VHF, they'll be 5 kilohertz. Doing the TDMA, and he's talking about what you were talking about, which is a repeater without a duplexer on a single frequency, spending a little bit of time with receive and a little bit of time with transmit. So you're talking about doing that too, but you're talking about a wider signal, not 5 kilohertz. You're talking about 25 kilohertz.
Yeah, but four channels.
And four channels. So
and full duplex, so it's really eight channels.
Okay, four receive and four transmit.
Yeah, at the same time,
So four repeaters running on one 25 kilohertz channel.
Right.
We're using 15 kilohertz. Well, on UHF, 25 kilohertz will work. I guess this would have to be UHF.
You can do 6.25 if you can do 12.5 and 25. It's switchable.
So you can narrow it down to work on 2 meters.
Yeah.
On a standard UHF channel, four. Frequency coordinators are going to
We have a hard time filling up one repeater in a town, so having four channels.
But they'll all be on networks, and they'll all,
We'll
just need a lot more hams to fill up all this space. But frequency coordinators, are they going to love you or hate you?
I really don't care. we have eight times more channels now in the same in the same spectrum.
Yeah.
So you can get 8 times more information through the same spectrum. Now I don't know what the interests of the coordinators are. You know, if they're really important and they wanna assign something that is a limited resource, they will hate me because we suddenly have far more resources.
Well,
if it makes their life easier, like the FCC, they will probably love us.
it will do both. Assuming that takes off, and it sounds like it's something that could. Now, instead of using two frequencies for a repeater, they're using one frequency for four, and the old input frequency becomes another
space
where they can put four more. That will, because in the U.S. and probably other places around the world, there are not enough frequencies, at least on 2 meters, mm-hmm. to do all the repeaters that everybody wants to put up in. Even medium metropolitan areas, not just the major metropolitan areas. So this would make it far easier to.
Not only that, you also save a lot of money. You know, when you look at the fusion repeater that you can get for $500, well, that sounds like a good deal. But if you need another $1,000 or $2,000 for these cans, it's not so good of a deal, and you still have to. About desensing, you know, if you take only four cans, you might still have some desensing if you have a higher output power. Yep. If you do a TDD approach, then you don't have any desensing.
TXRX is sell your TXRX stock now. Because this has got to be, I don't know if you guys have commercial aims, but I mean, so ham radio develops this, it's not going to stick in ham radio for very long.
We hope.
Are you guys going to do a commercial version? Are you thinking about that?
We'll use ham radio for what ham radio was intended for, as an experimental platform. And when it stabilizes, yes, I think there is commercial interest.
Duh. They're going to love it if it works. And we'll see. We'll see how well it works.
Yeah, we have been contacted.
You people out there, I hope you understand how revolutionary what Uri is talking about is. Do you think they do? Are you getting the sense that people?
Well, the people that are in the industry will immediately understand it. Yes.
Yeah. How far along have you gotten in making this work as the, you know, the four channel repeater system?
It works and is tested in the lab.
Okay. Put it up on a tower yet?
We'll do that. We tested it with one channel. With four, we'll test it later this year. That's part of the beta test program.
Okay. So like I say, that's the same thing that, David Rowe is talking about doing. And he doesn't have a mode out yet that could be included in your list of all the other modes that really exist, his VHF version of FreeDV, but it works on an open source codec, codec 2. Right now, you're relying on the proprietary AMBI codec, and there are some hams that get their get all bent out of shape about using proprietary codecs. I'm not one of them. But he does have an open source codec, and it is as capable, as I understand it, as the AMBI codec is, and maybe even could be better, even on VHF. Have you looked into codec 2 and its open source nature? And
yes, we did that. And I think we have to separate two things. On the one side, you have the codec. So basically, you have your 300 hertz, the 3 kilohertz going into that chip, and then you have bits coming out. That's the one thing. And then the other thing is the modulation, where you can do a lot of compression. The one is what you do on the RF side. The other one is what you do on the digital side. I think we can do a lot of compression on the RF side that has not been done yet, and get enough room, so to speak, in a 2.8 kilohertz channel that we have on HF to allow some forward error correction. Also, I think we have enough space to have pilot carriers in there that are allow us to correlate the phase of the pilot carrier with the phase of the data carriers, so that we don't need a 20 dB signal to noise. Or a very good signal, S9+, you know, in an empty band for digital modes to work, I think we can really make it work in congested bands. And I think that's where the work has to be done. Whether you do that with a DVSI chip or another one, you can use both. I mean, that's really, or the Chinese one. It was the University of Shanghai that developed that. You can use the one or the other, and we are willing to work with it. The free DV people, you know,
it's free.
We're open to this. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's available. You don't even have to ask. You could just go take it.
Right.
One of the things that I did see in a demo recently is, and one of the things he's trying to do with Codec 2 is to really drastically improve the signal to noise. And the demo that I saw, typically with all of the digital modes that we've got right now, as you reduce the signal, of course, the digital signal stays quiet until you reach a point where it kind of drops out. And if you were to go listen to an analog signal that is the equivalent signal, if it's well modulated, it's going to be very noisy, but you can hear and copy the analog signal another few dB weaker. The demo he did, you couldn't understand the analog signal at all. It was so noisy.
That's where we are going.
You're going there too.
You can 3 dB is enough, or you can even go into the noise, like in digital modes, like BPSK or so. You can't really hear it in there.
Yeah.
Because you have a more narrow channel than you have, let's say, in a typical audio channel.
So maybe your 20 watt radio will be okay.
Well, or you can maybe do a 20-meter QSO to Europe out of your car.
Yeah.
What you couldn't do now when there are not enough sunspots. Another possibility that you have in these modes is you can use your mobile as a repeater. So let's say you get out of range of your repeater, your mobile can be another repeater, and suddenly you have 3-4 times the range. You know, there's a lot of games you can play here.
Yeah. Well, crossband been around for a while, but this is still going to be simpler.
Now you can do it in the same channel.
So I had, I think, one more question as I look at all of these things. Well, we haven't talked about the LT at all yet, but we'll get there in just a moment. As we're looking at all these modes, they've got their own forms of control, things that you program into radios to make them work. I'm assuming that you have figured all that out, and so your radio will.
Well, we do it on the DV4. It's the same code that we have on the DV4. What we do here, you have to see the DV4 is basically two software defined radios, complete software defined radios, with analog to digital, digital to analog, FPGAs, protocols, everything in there, plus a very powerful PC, a very powerful Linux fork that we have in there. It is optimized for this task. So you have two SDRs in there that run more or less the software that we have on the DV4 Mini, and it runs there.
So the radio will talk to D-Star the way D-Star wants to be talked to, talk to DMR the way DMR wants to be talked to.
That's how we do it right now in the DV4 Mini.
Yeah, and can you go beyond it if... I mean, DMR was designed for commercial stuff. Can you add stuff into DMR radios that make it more ham friendly?
Oh, absolutely. Like the DMO mode, where you can have a repeater station on a simplex channel and stuff like that. Yeah. There is another problem that you have in DMR. Let's take DMR as a good example. You have two major brands in DMR worldwide. You have Motorola and you have Hytera. And both are great companies. However, you can talk from the Motorola to the Hytera, but you cannot exchange text messages. So you might have seen that on one of the pictures that was shown in Friedrichshafen. We have Facebook and Twitter on there. And some people said, no, this is going over the top. You know, this is crazy. Well, we are solving a problem. We can take the text message from Motorola, shoot it into a Twitter account, and then forward it, push it out on a Hytera radio, or a Fusion radio, or a D-Star radio. And that's why we have this interconnectivity that allows us to merge these systems and interconnect these systems. In this case, we use Twitter.
I guess I don't understand enough about texting ability of these various modes to see how you can run that stuff through your system and get it in and out of the radios. D-Star, D-Star's got its 1200 bits of ASCII data, mm-hmm. but it doesn't show up in the radio. You need something external to be able to handle that. What is that what you're using on the D-Star side to get in and out, text?
On the DMR side, yeah, you can do that. And in Fusion, you can even use it as a dedicated channel. Every mode has a different way to handle it, and that's why for the texting, Twitter as a common denominator.
Okay. It doesn't show up on the display of the radio. You need to...
It does. You can, yeah, your wife can transmit to your a text message that dinner is ready, you know, to your Twitter account, and it shows up on P25.
Yeah, I guess that opens up the Pandora box of unlicensed stuff and inappropriate stuff, and you got to be careful of filtering.
We have some barriers of entry there.
Okay. LTE. Let's take a look at this again. We're talking about this a little bit on the phone yesterday. The DV4 mobile will contain an LTE phone modem for the ordinary telephone system.
Well, it's really so-called M2M modem. In the LTE has different categories. It's LTE is not LTE. And there is a new LTE modem standard called Category 1. Category 1 is the so-called machine-to-machine modem, and it's intended to interconnect, for example, these streetlights that you can remotely control them. Or you can have a camera connected that counts cars or does all kinds of crazy things, you know, measures the water level in a river, stuff like that.
Now it still goes over the phone carrier systems, yes, Verizon, yes. Sprint, AT&T.
And these modems are relatively affordable. They are far cheaper than a normal phone. Also, the contracts that you get from certain carriers, so-called M2M carriers, are far lower. We are looking at about $1 per month, so $12 a year. And now you can't have as much data. You can't have gigabytes of data on that, but it works worldwide. And what we do, and that was kind of something born out of desperation. I'm doing support when people buy our product. And then you have this OM that is new to the mode, and we got his DV4 Mini up as well. Can you now help me to program my ABC380? I'm just making that name up. And I have to tell him I can't, not that I don't want to, but I can't, because there are so many different DMR radios, let alone P25. And an OM asked me this week about an IC7100. It is simply impossible for me to know each and every radio and how to program them. And then they exchanged these programming files called code blocks through the Facebook forum that we have. But it's still kind of thing that I don't like. And the next problem is you come to a different city, they have a different color code, which is like the PL tone in DMR. And everything is different. Then you come from one city, you come to the next city. The one city has DMR, the next one has D-Star, and the third one has Fusion. The learning curve becomes almost unbearable. And so we said, how can we overcome that? And as I'm commercially working in this field, we said, why don't we take that modem? And we have in the DMR Plus system, all the repeaters are connected to these central reflectors. But they are not only connected for voice purposes, but also we have all the configuration data. We have the frequency, we have the output power, we have the color code, we have the talk groups, we have everything in there. So we have in our CCS7 base everything we need to, when you turn on the DV4 mobile, just download it for the complete world. Download every call sign. There are 40,000 hams right now in the CCS7 database. And we have each and every of the Hytera repeaters at this point and the DCS D-Star repeaters in the database. And so we only have to take, let's say, the old stuff from the repeater book, add that to the mix. And every morning when you turn on the radio, it looks whether there is an update. Somebody changed the repeater frequency and it automatically changes it. And when you go to another city, you just see the repeaters that you that are there and you don't care about all these settings. And that is why we started this whole thing with the LTE. Now, suddenly somebody said, well, what if I'm in an area where there is no repeater, can I connect to the reflector through LTE? And again, first we rolled our eyes and said, it's kind of not really ham radio. But still, you have, you know, an old buddy that you didn't talk to for 20 years, and you have a nice conversation, and now you're getting out of the repeater range. Wouldn't it be great to switch over, you know, and use it anyway? Well, it won't be possible with the contract for that is intended for the setup. That's about 50 megabytes per month. But if you, there's a normal SIM card in there. If you pull the SIM card out, put a SIM card from any of the large carriers, you know, the T-Mobile, Verizon, AT&T, Sprint of the world, and put that in, then you can just switch over to LTE and continue with your conversation. But you might, if you do that every day through a gigabyte, then you have to pay for that.
Well, a gigabyte in a long time. Because, it's still a fairly small data stream.
Well, I have that number. We have AA4PP, which is mostly on U.S. Trust here, a repeater for in UHF and VHF here in Naples. And we used we have fiber now, but for years we used a T-Mobile router to connect it to the internet. And we used a Reflector 30 Charlie and Reflector 1 Charlie, and they are very busy. And we burned through about 3 gigabytes. So basically, if you let it run 24/7 channels, you have 3 gigabytes.
3 gigabytes in a month?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, that's not YouTube level, but it's...
No.
It's
but it gives you an idea. Yeah. You know, you won't get probably over 1.5 gigabytes, but it's more the incoming traffic. If you are on a reflector that where they babble, you can get and you have it running 24/7, you can get 1 or maybe 1.5 gigabytes, even with a 2,400 baud audio.
Yeah. To let people do their own calculation, well, D-Star is going to be 30 to 50 kilobits or so. I'm not sure what the other ones are, but they're going to be similar.
Yeah, they're all the same.
Yeah.
It's the same codec, you know, with the good sounding fusion stuff is maybe twice that. And then you can put other modes on it, you know, but in that range.
Yep. And for people that are complaining, it's not internet. Well, one of the problems is that these repeaters, the digital repeaters, aren't everywhere yet.
Yes,
they're getting to be more and more of them, but and to some extent, it's the Tower of Babel because one town might have DMR, one town might have D-Star. Fusion is getting out there because of the repeater deal. More and more of those are coming out.
Yeah, sure.
But until your repeater, we'll add four channel on one channel repeaters at the market.
We'll add more confusion to the whole thing, and we tried to clean it up with the LTE modem.
Yeah. Yeah, so that's good to have. Is there Wi-Fi in the box as well?
Yes, because we were concerned that some people don't want to use the LTE, so there is a Bluetooth and a Wi-Fi in there. So what you can do, if you don't want to use the LTE, you can download the database from the internet, sit with your notebook computer in your car, the radio access and access point, then you connect to it, and you can upload the database as well.
I imagine if your phone has the ability to create a little Wi-Fi hotspot, you could use that for a continuous connection.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, it's a computer. It's a router.
Yeah. All right. Let's see. Is there anything else I want to ask about here? Let me take a look at the website again.
Yeah. One interesting thing that we tested and showed in Friedrichshafen, you can do FM and let's say D-Star and DMR at the very same time. You can do two digital modes because we have two MB chips. And so you can even receive on D-Star and retransmit on DMR wirelessly at the same time, you know. But there's more stuff possible than we can think of, you know. It's crazy.
I'm way too old for this.
It's fun.
Okay, let me see if I can. So he doesn't notice what just happened. How much is it going to cost?
We think that we will start selling it for between $900 and $1,200, probably more on the upper end.
Okay. So the Bofung guys, they think it should be $35.
Yeah. Well, you can also make it $3.50, but the cost of these processors, of these boards, just to give you an idea, the little computer boards, which is a plug-in board, it's only the size of a stamp. Just for testing reasons, for the five boards, we pay 10,000 euros, which is about $12,000, just for an experimental board, just to get to the next step. And
no, it's ham radio. It's all, everything should be free.
Yes, I have heard that before. Then I would suggest that if someone can do that, you should do it.
All right. Is there anything we've missed? Anything that we have not covered in exhaustive detail that have been sitting in the back of your brain?
We covered it pretty much.
All right. It's because, we've been on here for a while. So this is going to be a very popular program. Thank you, Uri. I appreciate it. I'm going to look forward to seeing you down in St. Petersburg for the Digital Communications Conference, which gives me the chance to remind everybody that Ham Radio Now is running this Kickstarter. The Kickstarter is a little over $3,000 toward the $5,000 goal. You've got the opportunity for individual contributions at about any level you want. I've got a bunch of them that are set up as rewards, but there's no reward. They're just easy places to click. The only thing that actually has a reward to it is if you hit the $150 level, I will make you a little USB thumb drive with all of the programs on it in glorious high definition. And I've got two of the $500 corporate underwriter levels where I actually talk about you and who you are for 15, 20 seconds or so at the beginning of each program. Two of those are gone, and two of them are left. So if you know somebody that's got, a company or something that they want to get associated with this very high prestige technology conference, I'm just saying, Ham Radio TV, that's the place to stop by. Uri, thank you very much. Really appreciate that.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
Tell everybody once again who you are and where a good place to find you is.
Where we are located?
Yeah. We are on the web and stuff.
On the web. Well, we are wirelesshold.com is our website. Then we have a Twitter page, and we have a Facebook page. Actually, one for Wireless Hold, and then we have another one, which is DV4 Mini Support, where we have right now over 1,000 members, where there is a lot of stuff going on, and usually we try to take questions, if they are not answered by other users, ourselves within less than 24 hours.
Yeah. People beating on you real hard for this DV4 mobile?
It's terrible.
I mean, that is the other products are cool, but this is like way beyond, right?
Yeah, this is the last 20, 30 years I built a lot of computer and radio devices, but this is the wildest one in my life.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing it become reality. We're closer to reality than I was considering it as a result of this conversation. Hopefully, for a lot of you guys too. So, thank you very much. That will be it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. We did the Kickstarter thing, so stop by there. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ73, everybody. Over.
Bye.
And out.